and thanks for watching Edupedia World Videos. I am Vibhuti Parikh and today we are going to continue with our trade theories. Our next trade theory is factor endowment theory. The factor endowment theory was developed by Swedish economist Eli Heckscher and his student Bertil Ohlin. Paul Samuelson and Wolfgang Stockler has also made a significant contribution to this theory. The factor endowment theory consists of two main and important theorems, namely the Heckscher-Ohlin theorem and the factor price equalization theorem. The Heckscher-Ohlin theorem examines the reason for comparative cost difference in production and states that a country has a comparative advantage in the production of that commodity which uses more intensively the country's more abundant factors. The factor price equalization theorem examines the effect of international trade on factor price and states that free international trade equalizes factor prices between countries, relatively and absolutely, and thus serves as a substitute for international factor mobility. First of all, we will examine the Heckscher-Ohlin theorem. Heckscher-Ohlin theorem was examined on the basis of international trade. It explained that the international trade in terms of factor endowments. The classical theory demonstrated that the basis of international trade was comparative cost difference. However, it made little attempt to explain the causes of such comparative cost differences. The alternative formulation of the comparative cost doctrine developed by Heckscher and Ohlin attempts to explain why comparative cost differences exist internationally. They attributed international and inter-regional differences in comparative cost to, first of all, different privileging endowments of the factor of production, and secondly, the fact that production of various commodities requires that the factors of production be used with different degree of intensity. In short, it is difference in factor intensities in the production function of goods along with the actual difference in relative factor endowment of the countries which explains international difference in comparative cost of production. Thus, in a nutshell, the Heckscher-Ohlin theory states that a country will specialize in the production and export of the goods whose production requires a relatively large amount of the factors with which the country is relatively well endowed. In the Heckscher-Ohlin model, factors of production are regarded as scarce or abundant in relative terms and not in absolute terms at all. That is, one factor is regarded as scarce or abundant in relation to the quantum of other factors. Hence, it is quite possible that even if a country has more capital in absolute terms than other countries, it could be poor in capital. A country can be regarded as richly endowed with capital only if the ratio of capital to other factor is higher when compared to the other countries. For example, in country A, supply of labor is 25 units and the supply of capital is 20 units. Thus, here the capital labor ratio comes to 0.8 units. Whereas in country B, the supply of labor is 12 units, whereas the supply of capital is 15 units. Thus, our ratio comes to 1.25. As mentioned in the example, even though country A has more capital in absolute terms, country B is more richly endowed with capital because the ratio of capital to labor in country A, that is 0.8, is less than that in country B, which is 1.2. The two-country, two-commodity model of Heckscher and Ohlin is based on number of explicit and implicit assumptions. The most important assumption of this model are both product and factor markets in both countries are characterized by perfect competition. Factors of production are perfectly mobile within each country but immobile between countries. That is, the factor of production will not change the country at all. factors of production are of identical quality in both countries. Factor supplies in each country are fixed. They are not changeable. Factors of production are fully employed in both the countries. Factor endowment of one country vary from that of the other country. There are free trade between the countries, that is, there is no artificial barrier to trade, which is not practical at all in today's world. International trade is costless, that is, there is no transport cost, but in actual status there is a transport cost when it concerns to exports. The next assumption was, techniques of producing identical goods are the same in both countries. Due to this, the same input mix will give the same quality and quantity of output in both the countries. Factor intensity varies between goods. For instance, some goods are capital intensive and some others are labor intensive. The last assumption was, production is subject to the law of constant returns, that is, the input-output ratio will remain constant irrespective of the scale of operations. The next theorem was factor price equalization theorem. The factor price equalization theorem states that free international trade equalizes factor prices between countries relatively and absolutely, and this serves as a substitute for international factor mobility. International trade increases the demand of abundant factors, leading to an increase in their prices, and decrease the demand of scarce factors, leading to the fall in their prices. Because when nations trade, specialization takes place on the basis of factor endowments. According to Olin, the effect of inter-regional trade is to equalize commodity prices. Furthermore, there is also a tendency towards equalization of prices of the factors of production, which means their better use and a reduction of the disadvantages arising from the unsuitable geographical distribution of the productive factors. Since from each region, goods containing a large proportion of relatively abundant and cheap factors are exported, while goods containing a large proportion of scarce factors are imported. Inter-regional trade serves as a substitute of such inter-regional factor movements. Once we have gone through both the theorems, we'll now evaluate the factor endowment theory. The Hisko-Olin theory has been often criticized for its wrong assumptions. Studies conducted by Lernatoff and some others tend to question even the validity of this theory. Despite these drawbacks, however, the Hisko-Olin theory has certain definite merits also. What are these merits? First one, the Hisko-Olin theory rightly points out that the immediate basis of international trade is the difference in the final price of the commodity between countries. Although the actual basis or ultimate cause of trade is comparative cost difference in production. Thus, the Hisko-Olin theory provides a more comprehensive and satisfactory explanation for the existence of international trade. Secondly, the Hisko-Olin theory is superior to the comparative cost theory in another respect also. The Ricardian theory points out that comparative cost difference is the basis of international trade, but it does not explain the reason for the existence of comparative cost differences between nations. The Hisko-Olin theory explains the reason for the differences in the cost of production in terms of differences in factor endowments. This is another aspect that makes it superior to the Ricardian analysis. Thirdly, Hisko-Olin makes it very clear that international trade is but a special case of interlocal or interregional trade, and hence there is no need for a special theory of international trade. Olin states that regions and nations trade with each other for the same reason that individuals specialize and trade. The comparative cost difference are the basis of all trade, interregional as well as international. Nations, according to Olin, are only regions distinguished from one another by such obvious marks as national frontiers, tariff barriers, and difference in languages, costumes, and monetary system. Fourthly, the modern theory of trade is also called the general equilibrium theory of international trade because it points out that the general demand of supply and demand analysis applicable to inter-regional trade can generally be used without substantial changes in dealing with problems of international trade. Another merit of Hesko-Olin theory is that it indicates the impact of trade on product and factor prices. After the factor endowment theory, one of the most important theories of international trade is the product life cycle theory. As per Mr. Raymond Veron initially proposed the product life cycle theory in mid-1960s. Veron's theory was based on the observation that most of the 20th century is a very large proportion of the world's new products had been developed in US firms and sold first in the US market. For example, the mass produced automobiles, televisions, cameras, photocopiers, etc. To explain this, Veron argued that the wealth and size of US market gave US firms a strong incentive to develop new customer products. In addition to the high cost of US labor gave US firms an incentive to develop cost-saving process innovations. Just because a new product is developed by a US firm and first sold in US market, it does not follow that the product must be produced in United States only. It could be produced abroad to some low-cost location and then exported back into United States. However, Veron argued that most new products were initially produced in America. Apparently, the pioneering firms believed it was better to keep production facilities close to the market and to the firm's center of decision making, given the uncertainty and risk inherent in introducing new products. Also, the demand for the most new product tends to be based on non-price factors. Consequently, firms can change relatively higher prices for new products, which obviates the need to look for low-cost production sites in other countries. Veron went on to argue that early in the life cycle of a typical new product, while demand is starting to grow rapidly in United States, demand in other advanced countries is limited to the high income groups. The limited initial demand in other advanced countries does not make it worthwhile for the firm in those countries to start producing the new product. But it does necessitate some exports from the United States. Over time, demand for the new product grows in other advanced countries. As it does, it becomes worthwhile for the foreign producer to begin producing for their home markets. In addition, US firm might set up a production facility in those advanced countries where demand is growing. Consequently, production within other advanced countries begins to limit the potential for export from the United States. Here it is mentioned that when the product is introduced, that is, it is in an introduction stage, it is just produced in United States in this region. Here we can see that the product life cycle graph is similar for international trade and local trade similarly, but the difference is in the location of production. In the introduction stage, the production is done just in one country, whereas, as mentioned by Veron, in the growth stage, the production facilities can be shifted to another nations also. As the market in United States and other advanced nations mature, the product becomes more standardized and prices becomes the main competitive weapon. As this occurs, cost considerations start to play a greater role in the competitive process. Producers based in advanced countries where labor costs are lower than in United States might not be able to export to the United States. If cost pressures become intense, the process might not stop there. The cycle by which the United States lost its advantage to other advanced countries might be repeated once more. As developing countries begin to acquire the production advantage over advanced countries. Thus, the locus of global production initially switches from the United States to other advanced nations and then from those nations to the developing countries. That is, in the second stage, that is the growth stage, we were having the production only in advanced countries. From there, when the product is matured and standardized, it moves to other developing countries. That is where it comes the maturity stage of production. The consequence of these trends for a pattern of world trade is that over time, the United States switches from being an exporter of the product to an importer of the product as production becomes concentrated to lower cost region locations. That is, in the final decline area, the production of a product gets concentrated in the lower cost region countries. And the growth of production and consumption over time in United States and other advanced countries and developing countries becomes low. As now this product is standardized and there is a dire need to make a new product in order to remain in the market. Historically, the product lifecycle theory seems to be an accurate explanation of international trade pattern. Consider photocopier. The product was developed in early 1960 by Xerox in the United States and sold initially to US users only. Originally, Xerox exported photocopiers from the United States primarily to Japan and the advanced countries of Western Europe. As demand began to grow in those countries, Xerox entered into joint ventures to set up production in Japan, named as Fuji Xerox, and Greater Britain, named as Rank Xerox. In addition, once Xerox patents on the photocopier process expired, the foreign competitors began to enter the market. Example, Canon in Japan, Olivetti in Italy. As a consequence, US exports declined and US users began to buy some of their photocopiers from lower cost foreign sources, particularly Japan. More recently, Japanese companies have found that manufacturing costs are too high in their own countries, so they have begun to switch production to developing countries such as Singapore and Thailand. Thus, initially the United States and now other advanced countries have switched from being exporter of photocopier to importers. This evolution in the pattern of international trade in photocopiers is consistent with the prediction of the product life cycle theory that mature industries tend to go out of the United States into low-cost assembly locations. However, the product life cycle theory is not without weaknesses. Viewed from an Asian or European perspective, Venon's argument that most new products are developed and introduced in United States seems ethnocentric in nature. Although it may be true that during US dominance of the global economy, most new products were introduced in United States only. There have always been important exceptions. These exceptions appear to have become more common in recent years. Many new products are now introduced in Japan, for example, video game consoles, or Europe with new wireless phones. Also, with an increased globalization and integration of the world economy, a growing number of new products are now introduced simultaneously in United States, Japan, and advanced European countries. For example, laptop computers, compact discs, digital cameras, etc. This may be accompanied by globally dispersed production with particular component of a new product being produced in those locations around the globe where the mix of factor cost and skill is most favorable. In sum, although Venon's theory may be useful for explaining the pattern of international trade during a brief period of American global dominance, its relevance in the modern world seems more limited. Thus, all these theories are now becoming obsolete. The new trade theories are coming up in the market. So now we'll end our session with a promise of continuing with the new trade theories in our next trade theory session. Till then, thank you from my side and Edupedia World Videos.